Call the Higher Education and Career Readiness Policy and Finance Committee to order. First of all, we have minutes from the February 15th meeting. Do I hear a motion to approve?
So moved.
Representative Heitzman? Right?
Yep.
Representative Heitzman moves the minutes from February the 15th. Any questions? Corrections? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Minutes are approved. We have a number of bills today, and we've had a change of, I hate to do this. We had a change of schedule, a lineup.
So I'm
you're number two.
You're number two?
So move.
You're still number one to me.
And
squatter's rights don't count?
No. You take it up with the big guy that's coming up there.
Chair. Oh. In the name of liberty, I will move.
Okay.
Freedom. Freedom.
All right, so we have had a bit of a change in our lineup for committee, our bills today. First bill is House File 1142, and Representative Christensen, you want to move your bill?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I move House File 1078 for possible inclusion in the Higher Education Omnibus Bill.
You said 1078?
Oh. That's my bill being heard downstairs, Mr.
Okay.
Chair. I move House File 1142 for possible inclusion in the Higher Education Omnibus Bill.
Okay, very. Thank you very much. So go ahead, Mr. Representative Christensen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. You know, I want to have a discussion today. There's been a lot of talk about remedial classes and the need for a lot of students to take remedial classes when they get into a Minsky institution. You know, we've heard a lot of testimony in this committee in past sessions, and we've heard some this session, and I think we'll continue to hear testimony of students that did extraordinarily well in high school. We heard from students that received 4.0s, were on the honor roll, and all of these things, and then they got to Minsky and were told they needed to take essentially a full course load of remedial classes. And I want to start a conversation. I know Minsky has some concerns with the bill, and I'm looking forward to talking to them and working out a solution that'll work well for students, and that'll make college affordable, and that they'll still be able to graduate on time. I have a couple of testifiers, Mr. Chair, that to invite to come up at this time.
Okay.
And maybe they're not here yet, so maybe Minsky wants
didn't
to
get
come
the
up
memo.
And talk about the bill.
I'd like, if possible, maybe to have, could somebody maybe beef up the PA system just a little bit? Okay.
I'll talk loudly, Mr. Chair.
That's okay. So you are not sure whether you have testifiers?
Well, I do. I think they're on the way, but we'll, if Minsky would like to talk right now, they can come.
Okay, maybe we should call Minsky down. Unless someone have questions on the committee in the meantime? Apparently not, so. Welcome to the committee. If I could have you identify yourself for the record and then proceed.
Good afternoon. Can you hear me okay?
I believe so.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, Chair Nornes and members. My name is Paku Yang, and I am System Director of P20 and College Readiness at Minnesota State. I appreciate this opportunity to provide comments on House File 1142. We have shared this feedback with Representative Christensen and look forward to working with the author as the bill moves forward. I am joined today with my colleague Shirley Johnson, a faculty member at North Hennepin Community College. I will keep my remarks short as I would like Shirley to speak more from the faculty and the campus perspective. 30 of the 37 Minnesota State institutions are two-year colleges and are open admissions institutions. This means that our students come to us in any shape or form that they're in, and we help them to get to where they need to go by providing them with the academic preparation that is needed. Because of this mission and commitment, we have a very diverse group of students, including adult learners and English language learners. The students who typically place into developmental education courses are our most at-risk students, many of whom are from communities of color and lower socioeconomic backgrounds. A one-size-fits-all model does not work for our students. We need the flexibility to design models and programs that allow us to best serve this diverse continuum of students in our distinct communities across Minnesota. We cannot afford to leave any of our students behind by offering programs that only work for some students and not for all. In October of 2016, the Vice Chancellor of Academic and Student Affairs, Dr. Ron Anderson, and I provided a presentation to the Minnesota State Board of Trustees on developmental education. We reported that over the past 5 years, enrollment in developmental education courses has significantly declined. In 2012, enrollment in developmental education courses accounted for 6.2% of all FYE enrollment across our colleges and universities. By 2016, this proportion dropped to 4.2%, a reduction of nearly a third. This reduction in developmental course taking saved our students a total of $15.6 million in tuition and fees in 2016. This reduction is driven by a combination of factors, primarily among which are, one, new entering students coming to our colleges and universities are better prepared for college. For example, in 2012, 59% of these new first-time undergraduate students were enrolled in developmental education courses as compared to 47% in 2016. Secondly, our campuses have implemented curricular changes that are moving our students through developmental education courses sequences and into college-level courses more effectively and quickly. Our colleges and universities have been and continue to implement various models and programs that our faculty, staff, and administrators have put together. Many of these are tested true programs and models, and some are new promising approaches. As the research is strengthened, new models will arise. We need to allow for each post-secondary institution to develop research-based and evidence-driven programs and models on an ongoing basis without confining them to specific programs. The Minnesota State System has recently created a draft strategic roadmap that would advance our developmental education efforts across all of our colleges and universities. This strategic roadmap was developed through the collective engagement of faculty, staff, administrators, and students, and illustrates our commitment to supporting student success. It is currently in draft form, and we will use this spring for our campuses to review and refine the roadmap. Once finalized, this plan will advance our vision for developmental education, guide our priorities, set timelines and deliverables, and hold ourselves accountable for our work. In closing, I'd like to say that I know we all are committed to student success. We all care that students come to college ready. We all care that they have the necessary tools to be successful in their courses and their programs. And we all care that they graduate college and they're ready for the workforce. Developmental education opens the door for students who might not have had access to higher ed to get the necessary preparation so that they can be ready for college. And so I will close my comments here and invite my colleague to share a few of her comments.
Thank you.
Mrs. Johnson?
Yes, my name is Shirley Johnson, and I am a developmental faculty member at North Hennepin Community College. I want to emphasize the word developmental for a couple of reasons. One is that most of us in the field feel that approaching developmental education from a remedial perspective suggests that what we are in the business of doing is fixing students. That is not our perspective. We meet students where they are at, and we set them up for success by delivering programs that are relevant to their ongoing academic majors. So today, what I am here to do is I am here as a member of MSCF, a former NHCC Faculty Association president. NHCC is North Hennepin Community College, and co-chair of the Minnesota State Developmental Task Force. More importantly, what I'm here to do is voice my concerns on the concerns of many of my colleagues regarding this bill. So, what do I want to tell you? First of all, without question, all of us in this room recognize and are concerned with the increasing cost of higher education. As student debt loads rise, I think it is prudent for all of us to examine the ways in which we can deliver post-secondary developmental education in a more efficient and more effective manner. On the surface, this bill attempts to address this issue, and there are many features in the bill that align with best practices and things that the Minnesota state system is attempting to address. For example, I applaud the emphasis on the use of multiple measures, which we are already piloting within the Minnesota state system. I also find the emphasis on the use of supplemental instruction, the identification of math pathways, and the emphasis on acceleration as all positive. These are all promising practices, and they are included within the state developmental plan and reflective of national best practices. That said, here are my concerns. There is little question that supplemental instruction and acceleration are both promising practices within the field of developmental education. And many of our Minnesota state colleges, including my own, are already using them. That said, they are not the only promising practices in developmental education. My concern is that this bill limits our options. It limits the options that are available to us and places much of our focus on only those two options while closing the door on others that may be more effective. In addition, the Minnesota state student population is exceedingly diverse, and as a result, faculty must deal with a wide range of student abilities. My concern also is that our data suggests that supplemental instruction and acceleration are especially useful for some students, but not for others. Those others that I am referring to are those that need the time to learn the language, mathematics, and behavioral skills that create readiness for college learning. Sometimes that skill development simply takes time. It takes time, focus, and practice. Issues of acceleration oftentimes are not prepared to address those things. Most assuredly, it involves more than tutoring or additional study time. Supplemental instruction's value is in its relevance. It provides just-in-time instruction in those skill sets that are necessary for a specific course. It is questionable, however, whether these skills are transparent to the student and carried over to other courses that the student will take as a part of their academic career. Whether we like to hear this or not, there are some students who simply need systematic and comprehensive courses with defined learning outcomes to develop the skill sets they will need to be successful in their college career. The recommendations we have in place ignore the needs of these students and place us in a one-size-fits-all situation when we, as educators, know that one size does not fit all. Finally, I have some areas where I am simply flat out confused. The bill suggests that the transcript should identify what classes the student has taken that involve supplemental instruction. However, this becomes somewhat confusing as well as a daunting task when there are not specific learning outcomes associated with the supplemental instruction other than relevance. I would like further clarification concerning exactly what is transferring. Beyond this, a second area of confusion concerns the accelerated pathway. On the one hand, the bill suggests that colleges should create a pathway that students complete within 1 year. Then the bill goes on to state that students are not required to participate in developmental education for longer than one semester. I and our the colleges that are a part of our system need clarification on what exactly this means. Beyond this, meeting this requirement may be somewhat easier in well-defined areas such as English, but very challenging in math, where a student's pathway was defined by their chosen field of study. In closing, I would like to suggest to you that while I truly believe that the motivation for this legislation is honorable and that there are many positive features within it, there are some areas that where faculty are still concerned. Please recognize that we, too, understand the need for reform within our system and are taking steps to address this. That said, please also recognize, that some developmental classes can and do add value and contribute to the student's academic success. I recently completed my sabbatical, during which I examined research in two areas. One was successful developmental programs, and the second one was multiple measures assessment. Research done during this sabbatical convinced me more than ever that for our students to be successful, they need comprehensive integrated systems of supports that accept them for where it is that they are and give them the resources that they need to be successful. Sometimes this system involves more than speed. In addition, these resources are not the same for all students. The research from the Department of Education, from the University of Wisconsin System, and from the City University of New York all support this belief. I'd like to thank you again for this opportunity to testify. I'd be more than welcome to entertain any questions that you might have. And again, thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. Any questions from members? Representative Critwell. I was going to ask, have your other testifiers arrived?
Mr. Chair, yes.
Yeah, okay. Representative Schultz, did you want to ask a question now? Should we move on to the other testifiers?
It's up to you, Mr. Chair.
Okay, there are no questions apparently for you two.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. All right. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Chair Nornis, members of the committee. My name is Kenneth Abon, and I'm the Managing Director of Students for Education Reform here in Minnesota. We have been working on this issue for about 4 years now, and we are really, really happy about the work that this committee has put in, along with the rest of the legislature, and really making this issue relevant popular to work on it. You know, it's exciting to hear about many bills that are addressing remedial reform. A lot of communication in the media, research is being done across the country, and so it's exciting to see some momentum being behind a lot of our students that are struggling and need additional support. So I'm here to testify on behalf of this bill today because, you know, we have been very concerned about the numbers for our students who have to take remedial courses. We know that remedial courses have caused students to waste time and money and their college education that's not actually going towards their college degree. This has been, you know, the same problem, the same barrier that we've identified for the last 4 years now. And we think it's time that, you know, we really make sure that students have multiple pathways to access support that is more specific to them. And when we talk about trying to accelerate, to find accelerated pathways to support students, it's not to rush them through an education that we don't think it's necessary. I think that remedial courses in developmental education is very important for students because we know students are struggling when they come into college, whether it's right from high school or coming back from a 10 years off, or whether it's, you know, coming from a different country. And so we know that developmental education is very important for students. And we think that this bill provides additional pathways for students that gives students across the state access to those pathways. And so instead of having, you know, St. Paul College or Normandale having really good programs, which they do, to support students to take developmental education, we want those innovative programs to support students taking developmental education across the state, so that students across the state have that access. And we don't want to prescribe to any campus what is necessary for their students. We just want to make sure that students have the opportunities and have access to be accelerated through developmental education, because what's happening is that they're getting stuck in developmental education and students aren't finding ways to get over the remedial barrier. We know that it's a barrier to completion. This committee, along with the Senate committee, has already acknowledged that this is a barrier. And so we think it's time that we try to find ways to meet students at where they're at. And again, to the point that says that this is a one-size-fits-all model, I believe that it's not. I think that students have the opportunity to access credit-bearing courses, have the opportunity to still access developmental education, but in the middle, we have students that can access this alternative pathway that allows students to get the support that they need while also getting credit towards their college degree. And so I ask you today to support HF 1142 in order to support students so that we can have students meet the demands of our workforce and provide a more sustainable life for them past graduation. Thank you.
Thank you. Pronounce your last name again.
Abon, E-B-A-N.
Okay, thanks. Any questions of Mr. Abon or Representative Christensen? Okay. I guess there's
Mr.
not.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Was there an author's amendment we needed to put on?
Well,
better late than never, Mr. Chair.
I see it now. It's the DE1?
Yes.
Okay, we probably should do that.
Probably, Mr.
Probably.
Chair.
Okay. Would you like to?
I'll move the DE1 amendment, Mr. Chair.
Okay. And anything specific you need to, this is to get it in the shape you would like to have it, obviously.
Yes.
Okay. All those in favor of the DE1 amendment, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The DE1 amendment is adopted.
Okay. Can he talk about the amendment?
Can he? I don't think so.
Before we vote on it.
You can certainly. Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, Representative Schultz, this is some clarifying language. It reorders some things. A major thing that it adds is a reporting requirement by the Commissioner of the Office of Higher Education. Report the rate of remediation from school districts across the state. This was, it's an author's amendment, essentially, to get the bill in with the text I desire.
Is that sufficient?
How does it, thank you, Mr. Chair. How does it differ from the original amendment?
To the original bill?
Yes, yeah, sorry, to the original bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Chair, Representative Schultz, one of the main ways in which it differs, there's a series of numbering and other differences that I think all the members should have the copies of both in their folders. But one of the main substantive differences is the delete all inserts a provision that requires the Office of Higher Education to report the rate of students that come from various school districts in Minnesota, at what rate they're needing to enter remediation programs when they get to college.
Schultz, is that okay? All right, any other representative?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Representative Christensen, do you know if there's a cost attached to this bill, or is there going to be having to have to be an additional appropriation for Minnesota State? And also, with the supplemental education, supplemental instruction, is that going to have to be done by faculty? Are they going to have to be putting in more hours for the instruction? Have you spoken with the two-year and four-year faculty at all about the bill?
Christensen?
Mr. Chair, Representative Lean, I've talked with Minnesota State and faculty, and they're, you know, they have concerns. I think there's a lot of proposals on this issue that are, we're going to examine this session. Representative Zerwas has a bill on this issue, so I'm looking forward to working with all the stakeholders, bringing everybody in, and I think we can really agree on a bill that'll work well for students and will really address the root of the issue. You know, nobody's trying to throw around blame here. Nobody's trying to, you know, there's great work being done in the K-12 system, and there's great work being done at Minnesota State. But there's some changes that need to happen within the system to make it work better for students. And I think bringing everybody together, I think this session will, this is the beginning of a conversation that'll I think will arrive at a good outcome for students. As far as the first part of your question, Representative Lean, as far as cost, there's not a fiscal note on this yet, and that's generally in anticipation of the fact that this bill will likely change in form as we continue the conversation.
Representative Lean? Okay. Any other questions? Oh, Representative Schultz.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Your hand there.
What does intrusive advising mean?
Christensen?
Mr. Chair, could you point me to the line, Representative Schultz?
4.7.
Okay. Mr. Chair, Representative Schultz, my testifier would like to comment on that.
Yvonne? Yeah. Chair Nornes, Representative Schultz. So intrusive advising is supposed to mean when we can identify that a student is in need of additional support, that we can step in and advise them in the direct coursework to take in order to get the support that they need, whether that is they take a traditional credit-bearing course or that they take an alternative pathway, whether they take, you know, a developmental ed or remedial education course. It is meant to help students, you know, take a step in the right direction to find the direct support that they need. And that's what the bill is meant to do. That's kind of what some of the language that we've used in the past, and we've, you know, talked it through with other stakeholders. And they have generally appreciated some of that supportive language for students.
Representative Schultz? Okay. All right. Anyone else? Yeah, Representative Haley.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, Representative Christensen, for bringing this forward. I have some questions on it as well, so I was pleased to hear you say that this is a conversation and a topic that will continue to be worked on, because I think there are some areas that could be improved. So that's a good point. I appreciate wanting to help students right away, because I understand when students come in, let's say algebra, they're struggling with algebra, maybe they're going into a welding program and they're not going to need that level of algebra for their career, and yet they get disenfranchised early and drop out and then don't get the skill that they're interested in, and they're not moving forward to employment or accreditation. So if we can build in what is the math skill level that's needed for that career interest, that's a good win for everybody. So I just wanted to comment, I support where you're headed, and if there's additional work with the institutions that we can land on a spot where everybody wins, that'd be great.
Okay, anyone else? Probably should ask anyone else in the audience, I guess, if they'd like to testify. Otherwise, I believe, any closing comments?
I thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, committee members, for allowing me to present this bill. I think, you know, I'm really looking forward to the conversation this session on how we can create a system that works better for students. You know, we've heard over and over again in this committee and in other committees, K-12 committees, students coming forward that were, by all standards of measure, we're doing great in high school, and we're exceptionally well prepared for college in terms of GPA and class rank and things like that, and then they get to college and they're told that they're nowhere near ready for college. And I don't think in the state of Minnesota, a student in high school should get a 4.0 and then get to MinSCU and realize they're not prepared for college. And, you know, I think this bill acknowledges that a lot of the concern, the problem there is some K-12 schools are not preparing these students for college. And I think we in the legislature need to be concerned that students are graduating with exceptional GPAs and then are reaching college and realizing they're entirely unprepared. And I think that's, you know, essentially they're being misled by their K-12 school telling them that they're doing well, they're doing fantastic even, and then they get to college and they're not ready. So I think the reporting requirement, especially by the Office of Higher Education, is important. I'm looking forward to continuing the conversation with Minnesota State and hearing Representative Zerwas's bill, and I think we'll arrive at a good outcome. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
All right. House File 1142 then will be held over for possible inclusion. Okay, next we have House File 1369, Representative Urdahl. Okay. All right. Well, Representative Urdahl is getting situated. We do have some students, I believe, here today from Hibbing, Moorhead, Anoka Tech, MSTC, and maybe others too. I don't know. But if you want to raise your hands, stand up, don't yell. Oh, good. Welcome. Welcome. Thanks for being here.
Thank you for having us.
Okay. We're really anxious to get to hear what you have to say, Representative Hurd, also.
I can tell you could barely contain your excitement.
I know.
Chairman.
House File 1369, I'll move House File 1369 for possible inclusion, and you may go ahead.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is similar to the bill that we had last session on College Possible. This program makes college possible for low-income students. The program involves curriculum intensive support provided by AmeriCorps members. This occurs during the high school students' junior and senior years. The support continues as the students attend college at our institutions throughout Minnesota. AmeriCorps members teach after-school classes with students enrolled in the program. As juniors, students learn about the college application process, preparation for ACT, SAT, they learn about college life and the importance of college. As seniors, they are taken through the college application process, the financial aid process, scholarships, and learn about the transition to college. While in college, the College Possible students are supported all the way through college graduation, including everything from study skills to choosing a major to understanding college credits. With legislative support, the program has begun an expansion throughout Minnesota. The purpose of this bill is to continue to expand the program with an emphasis on continued expansion into rural Minnesota. 98% of the students in the program earn admission to college. The program is currently in multiple high schools with several schools on waiting lists. College partners in the program include Augsburg, St. John's, St. Ben's, Mankato State, St. Catherine, Princeton on the Prairie, and the University of Minnesota. That was St. Cloud State, yeah. Princeton on the Prairie. Our hope is to make this excellent program available to many more students throughout Minnesota.
You have testifiers, Mr. Representative Urdahl?
Yes, I do, Mr. Chairman.
All right, might as well welcome to the committee and identify yourself, please.
Thank you. Mr. Chair, members of the committee, my name is Sarah Jook. I'm the Executive Director of College Possible. I'm here today to testify in support of House File 1369 and would like to start by thanking Representative Urdahl for bringing this forward today. College Possible is a nonprofit organization working with students and high schools across the state. We currently have students in 55 partner high schools across the state and enrolled at more than 60 colleges and universities across the state of Minnesota. All of our students are low-income students with an average household income of $25,000 a year. 90% of our students are students of color, and 90% of our students are first-generation college students. We start working with students as juniors in high school. and support them all the way through their college graduation. We work with those students to increase their college entrance exam scores, to apply for college, to secure financial aid, to enroll in college, to persist, and ultimately to graduate from college. The results of our organization are unmatched. 99% of our students earn admission to college, and our students are four times more likely to earn their college degree than their low-income peers. We have a long history of strong educational evaluations. We operate at approximately one-sixth the cost of similar federally funded programs, and the return on investment of our program is 333%. 80% of the money that we raise as an organization is raised from the private sector, so individuals, corporations, and foundations provide most of the support for our organization, with the remaining 20% coming from the state of Minnesota, as well as several federal government competitive grants. With me today, I do have two of my colleagues that have intimate knowledge of the organization and of the students that we work with, and I would love to have them have an opportunity to speak as well.
All right, have them come forward. Welcome to the committee, and somebody start, identify yourself first, and then proceed.
Excellent. Well, thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the committee. My name is Kumar Balasubramanian. I am a high school program manager with College Possible. I started my career, my very first career after college, was actually as an AmeriCorps member with College Possible. And so I feel very honored and privileged to be able to testify for this today. It was a transformative experience for me. I'm a St. Paul native. I grew up here in Minnesota, and I went to St. Olaf College. I graduated with a history and exercise science degree, and I had no idea what that meant or what I could possibly do. I knew that I wanted to get my hands dirty, and I wanted to learn and give back to my community. And what I learned about both being a young professional as well as the educational system here in Minnesota has made me a better person and a better citizen for the state of Minnesota. And so I want to speak in part to the transformative experience that being employed by College Possible has provided me. And the biggest thing is the connection that I've been able to draw to the students. The students that we work with are some of the most incredible, amazing, passionate, intelligent people that I've ever come in contact with. And you know, I knew that there was barriers for people of color. I knew that there were barriers for students coming from low-income backgrounds. But it was really eye-opening to get into a classroom and to work with them on a college application and see those barriers pop up. And so the students I worked with graduated in 2013. And so the ones who are on track should be graduating from college this year. And I've stayed in really close contact with a lot of those students, and it's been so rewarding to be able to see those students from when they were juniors in high school, sort of just figuring out what it meant to be a college student, to now about to graduate from the University of Minnesota with plans to become human resources professionals or professional models or fashion designers. A student of ours graduated a year early and is now working at Roseville Area Middle School to help support current middle school students on a similar path. And so it's meant so much to me to be involved in these students' life, and I've seen it work on the ground. One of the most unique aspects of our program is we take recent college graduates and have them be the mentors for our students. Students need to be empowered, and they need to see themselves in the people who they're working with. And our program is unique in that the people who they work with at their school are distinctly different from the teachers who they work with during the day. And that's not a bash on teachers. Teachers are some of the most wonderful, amazing people as well. But there's something different about a mentorship than there is about a teacher. And so I think that there's an opportunity there for our students to really bond and connect and trust that there's somebody there who's got their back, who's going to support them all the way until they gain a bachelor's degree. And the last piece that I would want to touch on is just I think a lot of these students are receiving messages that they're not college material. And a big piece of what our program does is it tells every single student that if you are willing to work hard and if you care about your future and your success, we can help set you up and put you on a path to become a college graduate.
Thank you very much. Very well done. And next.
Mr. Chair, thank you. My name is Vincent Henry Jr. I am a senior coach at Roosevelt High School and Edison High School, current AmeriCorps volunteer or server through College Possible. But my journey with College Possible began 8 years ago as a junior at Robbinsdale Armstrong. I joined College Possible to get more support as a first-generation low-income student. I didn't know what the FAFSA was. I didn't know what the ACT was or what was on the ACT. My coach worked hard with me to help me increase my ACT score by 5 points, and then helped me apply to colleges, research the right college fits for me, and finally found a home at Augsburg College. Once I got to Augsburg College, I was met with support that helped me through the whole college process and things of that nature. And then once graduating from College Possible on time, I became interested in working for College Possible because of how much support they gave to me. That is not an isolated incident of how much success College Possible helps our students achieve. It is happens every single year with our students, so that's why I'm testifying in support of this bill.
All right, thank you very much. Questions? Representative Pryor.
Thank you, Chair Nornes. I just want to hear more, if that's all right. And one question I have is it typical that you work with the same coach from junior to graduation?
Yep. So usually it's a 1 year or a 10-month term of service when you join, and then you have to reapply to the program the following year. The best hopes with having the same senior coach as junior year. In my experience, I had the same coach both years, just because of that continuous support is really helpful. But sometimes that's not the case, and then we find the best people to help fill those spots.
Mr. Chair, Representative, I'd love to add to that. Yeah, so our ideal situation is to have that continuity for students. You know, there's lots of people who pop in and out of students' lives, and as much as we can, we want to provide that. But also the goal is to make College Possible represent the support system that they'll have. So a student is going to have a different coach once they go to college than who they had in high school, no matter what. And so one of our goals is to make them know that, you know, the individual is important, but the organization of College Possible will always be here for you no matter what. So I was a coach for 2 years, and I was able to work with that same group of students, and I think that meant a lot to them. But now they have a new college coach, and they know that because of the relationship that they developed with me, College Possible is a caring person who's going to be there for them moving forward.
Thank you. Representative Omar.
Thank you, Chair. First, I wanted to congratulate Representative Urdahl for believing in this program and for putting it forth, and thank you all for the work that you do. I know firsthand how amazingly supported the students feel in your program, and as a graduate of Edison, I want to thank you for being there and being with those young people. I think one of the things that's particularly powerful about this program is that a lot of young people who are struggling in schools oftentimes feel like college is never possible because they don't have members within their communities who have experienced college life. And having young people like yourselves as their mentors who have experienced college, guiding them and making that tangible for them is really helpful. My sister always jokes that you can't be what you can't see. And I think it is a powerful statement for some of these young people to see you all and to see themselves in you and to feel like it is really possible. So I'm glad we're doing this, and I'm glad to hear your testimony. And again, I just want to thank Chair Urdahl for putting this forth.
All right, thank you. Representative Jessup.
Thank you, Chair. It's great to hear about these experiences. Could you just take us through how do you work with the kids? Is it in tandem with the teachers during the day? Is it after school? Just give some detail there. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely.
Before you answer, can you pronounce your name real slow for me?
Absolutely. So my name is Kumar Balasubramanian. So that last name is sort of like bowl of soup and onions.
Okay.
Bala Supermanian.
I got it the first time. Just wanted to be sure. Okay, go ahead.
Awesome. Thank you, Mr. Chair. And thank you so much for the question, Representative. So we do certainly work in tandem with teachers, but our programming happens primarily after school. And it's a huge commitment. So our students need to come for 2 hours twice a week. the entirety of their junior and senior year of high school. So as you can imagine, not every high school student is super excited about leaving 8 hours of classroom work to come study for the ACT right after that. And so the main collaboration that we have with teachers and counselors is during the school day. So even though our program's after school, our coaches have an office in the building and they're there all day building relationships, sometimes going to study halls to pull students out to help them work on a college application, sometimes meeting with the case manager to learn more about one of their students' IEPs. So we are certainly separate from the high schools themselves, but we need the support of the schools to be able to get the things done that we need to do. Like, a student can't get into college if their counselor doesn't send their transcript. And so oftentimes we'll sit down with the counselor before the college application season and say, okay, here's College Possible system. We want each of our students to apply to at least 5 good fit colleges. How can you help connect us through your system so our students are doing things the way that you need them to do to get them out? Or if a student, let's say, is having trouble in a specific class, we might meet with the teacher and that student to see what's going on and how they could focus. Maybe they need to stop going to College Possible sessions after school for a few days so they can go make up a test with that teacher or go do some of that extra homework. So we're after school, and then we also have quite a few weekend activities. So we do service events, and we do campus tours, bringing students onto college campuses, as well as a few sort of celebration events at the end of the year to sort of cap off all the hard work that our students have done. Does that fully answer your question?
Jessup, one more follow-up.
Thank you, Chair. One more follow-up question. This is great. Thank you for the detail. Tell me real quick, do you work with one school or do you work across 2 or more campuses?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair and Representative. So each, it's individual for all of us. We're in 26 high schools here in the metro area and then another 35 in greater Minnesota. But typically a coach who is campus-based, so has an office in a high school, works with just that one school. There are a few instances, like Vincent, who are split coaches, so the enrollment of specific schools or students signing up for our program, there's only enough for a half cohort. So a typical cohort, we do cohort model too. It's all about students being in community with other students who are going to push them towards being successful. But some schools, we can only get 20 students as opposed to the full 40, so we'll have a coach split between those two schools. We also, for greater Minnesota, have a tech-connected model. So the coaches who are serving students on the Iron Range or down in Rochester are actually based here in the Twin Cities and connecting them with them through their phone, through texting, through the internet, Skype for business, things like that. And so those folks will be working with many different schools. There might be someone who's working with a school century in Rochester and then also working with some students up in St. Cloud. And so it depends on the model of coaching that they're doing.
Representative.
Very good. Thank you.
Okay, Representative Haley.
Thank you, Chair. A couple of questions. For the grant amount here, how many students would be served? How far does that money extend?
Mr. Chair, we'll bring in the big guns for this one.
All right. Ms. Henry.
Mr. Chair, Representative, what we've been doing with the funds is really using the dollars to grow our program in greater Minnesota. And so this year the program is supporting 300 high school students throughout the state, as well as students on some specific campuses. All of our college students on the Minnesota State University Mankato campus, our students on the Augsburg campus, the St. Cloud campus, and St. John's St. Ben's. And so we've got approximately 400 students that the funding will support on those college campuses, and then 300 plus that will be supported in the high school program.
Can I?
Representative Haley.
And so for your outstate locations, did I understand that was all you know, via Skype or technology, or are you actually now putting advisors in outstate locations as well?
Henry.
Mr. Chair, Representative, our high school students are all supported via technology with an advisor that is here in St. Paul because they're so widespread. So we might have a coach working with a student in International Falls, and the next afternoon they're working with a student in Cannon Falls. But our college coaches are on those campuses. So where we have larger numbers of students, we have college coaches that physically have office space on those campuses and see students face to face. So we have a coach that's full-time in Mankato so that they can see their college students every day. And we have the same at the University of Minnesota, Augsburg, St. Cloud, St. John, St. Ben's, and a few other institutions where we have higher enrollment.
For outstate,
Haley.
Thank you, Chair. Sorry. For outstate locations, like communities like mine, maybe there's opportunities to partner. I know the Rotary organizations have some type of, you know, college mentorship program, or there's other educational partnership coalitions, public-private, that are trying to come together. This is an issue for, you know, all of us across the state. So if your model seems to work and work very well, so the more you can extend that through partnerships, would be great. I also just one last question, Chair. Is your program, when you say college, strictly, I see four-year colleges. Do you work with two-year?
Ms. Henry.
Mr. Chair, Representative, we do support students no matter where they choose to attend. So approximately 30% of our students are enrolled at two-year institutions, and the other 70% are at four-year institutions. And it's pretty, the other 70% are pretty well split between the Minnesota State 4 years, the Minnesota private colleges, and the University of Minnesota system.
Thank you.
Representative Urdahl, there's a lot of interest, as you tell or can tell by the conversation. Good testifiers. We could go on for a long time, but in the interest of time, I think you need to wrap this up.
I've been talking too much, Mr. Chairman.
I know.
I apologize for that. I thank you for the past support that you've given this program, and look forward to your future support, and appreciate the questions.
Okay. Then House File 1369 will be held over for possible inclusion. Thank you very much. Okay, next, Daniels. Representative Daniels, would you like to move your bill? And
yes, I'd like to move bill number 1189 for possible inclusion.
All right, and then begin.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, committee, for hearing our bill. Our bill has to do with an upcoming trend of shortage of veterinarians. Veterinarians are very unique and qualified to protect the health of both animals and people. They also serve on the front lines for the outbreaks of animal diseases that can devastate livestock industries and endanger lives of humans. But the nation is facing a shortage in that field, and this bill will hopefully encourage students to go into the veterinary field. It's nothing new. We started doing that in 2009. And for more details on the bill, I'm gonna turn it over to Dr. Molgaard, and she has a lot more details, and I have a plethora of testifiers. We'll try to keep it somewhat short and sweet.
All right, very good. Dr.
Molgaard.
Molgaard, welcome to the committee, and please proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So my name is Laura Molgaard. I am a veterinarian and the Associate Dean for Academic and Student Affairs at the University of Minnesota College of Veterinary Medicine. I've brought a couple of students with me today as well. And we're here to talk about the importance of providing additional funding for a rural large animal loan forgiveness program. As Representative Daniels said, veterinarians are on the front lines of protecting not only animal but human health. Veterinarians, when they take their oath at graduation, pledge to protect the public health. It's one of our roles as veterinarians. Most people are more familiar with small animal veterinarians, and that's certainly an important role to fill. But what we're talking about here is protecting the food supply and the agricultural economy. So veterinarians work with producers to keep their animals healthy and protect the bottom line, protect the health of people through the food supply, milk, eggs, meat, etc.
And veterinary medicine, like other health professions, is a time-consuming field to go into. Students go to school for 4 years of undergraduate school and then an additional 4 years of medical school. So 8 years of school means a lot of tuition, a lot of student debt. And to be able to serve rural Minnesota, where incomes are not as high, we need to be able to provide loan forgiveness for these graduates.
All right, there you have some students, you said.
Yes.
Would they like to be next?
Mr. Chairman.
Welcome.
My name is Jennifer Gretsch. I am a third year veterinary student at the University of Minnesota. I am originally from Albany, Minnesota, Central. I guess what I want to talk about today is that I, along with a lot of other of my colleagues, will be coming out of school with $150,000 plus for debt. Mine will be close to $230,000. This includes both undergrad and my graduate program amounts. And the average salary for a rural food animal veterinarian is between $50,000 and $67,000. Excuse me. And it's just one of those things where we feel that it's really hard to make those decisions financially, to want to go into these, like, we're passionate about what we do. I'm from a dairy farm originally. I've always grown up with livestock, and I love the profession, and I love working with farmers and being in agriculture, but it's a hard decision financially sometimes to make that decision to go for the lower salary when we can work in small animal medicine and make more, or even go to into public service, or go on and do residencies and those kinds of things. And I guess what I would kind of like to talk about too is that we are providing us, like, we're an asset to Minnesota and to the agriculture industry as a whole. We provide, like Dr. Bolivar was saying, that we are at the forefront in monitoring certain diseases. Even influenza was one of them. Foot and mouth disease, which is a foreign animal disease, could be another one. Chronic wasting disease, etc.
How close will you graduate this spring?
I graduate in May 2018.
Okay. Well, it's been a long road, but we understand. When you said you've got a debt that high, that's mm-hmm. That's an investment.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. Well, we may have some questions. If you want to just stand by, we have another student, I believe. Yep. Right?
Any questions?
Chairman?
Yeah, we'll interrupt if there's questions. Just go ahead and give your testimony.
Okay, Chairman. My name is Joe Hammes, and I'm a third-year veterinary student at the University of Minnesota, interested in practicing food animal medicine. And instead of talking about how this is going to benefit us, I like to start with how this is going to benefit Minnesota. And a quote that I really like to talk about is, basically, if you ate today, you should thank somebody that works in agriculture, because the further we have become separated from where our food comes from, there's been a lot of issues with public perception of how food is produced and how our animals are raised. And veterinarians play an absolutely pivotal role in making sure animals are raised the right way and basically are raised ethically up to our standards. And part of the problem in Minnesota, I think, is that there's a huge population center in the Twin Cities, and a lot of times we don't really understand that a ton of our population also exists outside of the Twin Cities area, and a lot of those areas are agricultural based, and it's becoming more of an issue that we don't understand where our food comes from. So in a nutshell, food animal veterinarians play an absolutely pivotal role in providing safe food for everyone. And I think it's, the student debt, obviously, like we touched on, is a big problem. And to help vet students out in that regard, it's going to be very helpful.
Did you say where are you in the process? Are you also going to graduate?
Yes, I'm also in my third year, so I'll graduate next year, spring.
Okay. Well, congratulations on that. Any questions from members? If not, we have another testifier. You want to grab one of those two microphones and just proceed? Tell us your name, Mr. Chairman, and then begin.
My name is Tom Haggerty. No, I'm not a student. I was many years ago.
Would have fooled me.
But I am a veterinarian, and I'm representing the Minnesota Veterinary Medical Association. And we strongly support this request. As you heard the testifier say, almost $250,000 in debt. Going to take a long, long time to dig out of that hole. We need veterinarians in outstate Minnesota for the food supply, for the diseases like the turkey diseases, the avian influenza, the chronic wasting disease. We have all sorts of diseases that affect the food animal supply. And we need these folks, like these two folks, out there in the rural areas of the state with the livestock. But it's so hard for them to get over that debt. Doing large animal work, that's much easier doing small animal, where you get more patients closer together and you run them faster. But at any rate, as veterinarians get fewer and fewer in the country, we need more and more ways to get them to come out there. And this loan forgiveness program is a very good way. The way it's set up now, a veterinarian will get that qualifies. We'll get $15,000 a year for 5 years, which is $75,000, which goes a long ways for most of the debt. I think most of the debt is more like $135,000. So that will help at least to pay about half of the debt. And we need to get all of the veterinarians we can out into greater Minnesota. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
At the university, what's the enrollment? Is it hard to find students who want to become veterinarians? Any?
Mr. Chair. The University of Minnesota is working on trying to get more food animal interested people, but currently I believe my class specifically, which has 100 people in it, I would say about less than 10% are interested in working with food animal.
Oh, okay.
Mr. Chair, I can give a little bit more information on that if you'd like. So one of the things we've done at Minnesota that's unique is we created a food animal recruitment program we call VetFast, Food Animal Scholars Track. And we've been successful with that in recruiting more food animal students than in many other veterinary schools. What we need to do is then keep them in food animal practice rather than the, I wouldn't really say lure, but the necessity of being able to pay back that debt makes it hard for them to choose to stay in that career path.
Okay, thank you very much. Question, Representative Pryor.
Thank you, Chair Nornes. As I understand the legislation, it says if you get this forgiveness if you're 50% your practice is involved in food animal.
Yes.
And then does that get it out to the areas where where the need is? I mean, could somebody just work, in Minnetonka and drive over to Waconia and take advantage of this? I mean, does it get around the state where you need the veterinarians?
Yeah, when the original bill was designed, I'm sorry, Mr. Chair. When the original bill was designed, it was carefully designed to look at the counties that had the need and the veterinarians who are serving those communities, even if they wanted to live in the Twin Cities and commute for many, many hours. I guess there aren't too many that would do that, but it's veterinarians who are practicing in the parts of Minnesota that have that need.
All right, any other questions? We have another testifier. I forgot that. Invite people out of the audience. Nice you just volunteered. That's good.
Yeah.
Welcome.
Mr. Chairman, members, my name is Tom Peterson. I represent the Minnesota Farmers Union. And we too support this bill. I'm not going to rehash all the things that you've heard. But two of the things that really got us this last year, and we've supported this bill and idea for many years, was late this summer, we had a couple of sale barns, and many of the rural people have sale barns in your district, had a hard time finding a veterinarian that could be on call that has to be there to check in the livestock. And we're very close to closing down. They worked with us, and the owner of one, he would call me every day and say, we're going to close down. We're not, all these farmers are going to be stuck. And he was adding increased pay and incentives, and we're just having a hard time because of retirements. And the second thing that happened at the same time was I had several county fairs call me almost all at once, and we're having a hard time getting a veterinarian because of retirements to check in their livestock for their county fair. It's also a requirement for 4-H. Many of the rural members know that. And so we can see this problem starting to mushroom. And so I encourage your support for this legislation. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Peterson. Okay, any other questions? Any other testifiers? If not, Representative Daniels, you would like to have a closing comment?
Yes, I just appreciate your time. I know it's going to be an issue with the majority of the veterinarians. Average age is now in the mid-50s, I believe. So in the next 5 to 10 years, there's going to be a real shortage. And that's why we really want to try to get this program going for a number of students for the next 5 years to go through the program and, you know, start to be ready for when we have the other veterinarians retiring. Right. So it's an urgent need. And, you know, if you like steak, if you like pork, you know, we need to think about the safety of it. And like the disease we had of the avian flu 2 years ago, that these veterinarians are on the front line. That's what sometimes keeps our food safe or not. So to me, it's a very important bill, and I hope we'll get to consideration.
All right. Thanks for the testifiers and for everyone. House File 1189, then will be held over for possible inclusion. Next up, House File 1206, Representative Albright.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to move House File 1206 before the committee. And I do have an author's amendment, the A2 amendment, that I'd like to put onto the bill, to put the bill in the shape that I would prefer it.
All right. Just a simple explanation of that amendment.
Happy to do so, Mr. Chair and members. What this actually does is change the number of the members on the board from 12 to 14, and it also reasserts some funding for the grants in the year 2018. As opposed to just in the year 2019.
Okay. Members, the A2 amendment, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The amendment is adopted. You have brought some friends.
I have. Mr. Chair, and I just have some brief comments, but I will certainly be happy to shut up and let them speak for the imperative that is House File 1206. Mr. Chair, the bill before us as amended today continues some of the most important work that I think our state can provide to those amongst us that are suffering from these very tragic and traumatic injuries. It's important work in the areas of both spinal cord injury and traumatic brain injury research that the state candidly smartly funded in 2015. The current program is managed out of the Office of Higher Education with a 12-member council of spinal cord injury and traumatic brain injury experts, and since 2015, eight $125,000 grants have been awarded with the focus on functional recovery and rehabilitative techniques for these two injuries. You have in your packet a letter, and I will draw your attention to it. Looks something like this, the Minnesota Spinal Cord and Traumatic Brain Injury Research Grant Program. And if you'll just turn it over to the back side, you will note those grants that have been awarded. I will not be the first one to admit that I can't pronounce the names that are mentioned here, but candidly, this is the work that scientists are doing on the behalf of the heroes amongst us that suffer with these maladies. And so I think they're doing great work. This really is a unique program in that we've fostered a private-public partnership with the funds that the state has invested. Three of the eight grant programs awarded brought in an additional $1.24 million in external industry grants. The state funding was seed money to get researchers in place and to develop their research parameters. I'm excited by this private-public partnership because the same types of funding streams have brought great success in other states. As example, California invested $15 million in spinal cord injury research and saw $86 million in NIH federal funding, which helped establish a base for the research they are undergoing there. Minnesota is a world-class leader in the medical community, being home to both Mayo and the University of Minnesota, and I believe some additional state funding could bring extensive research dollars to our state on behalf of this research already started. Current market forces are not adequate for some of this research because of the low population and lower return on investment compared to larger health issues such as diabetes, heart disease, and cancer, but nonetheless, it is important work. This funding could also save significant dollars in the future if we are able to develop treatments to help individuals living with SCI and TBI in Minnesota. Almost 11,000 people in Minnesota suffer from a spinal cord injury, and healthcare costs for those individuals range from between $65,000 and $140,000 a year. I have two testifiers with me today who would like to speak on behalf of this legislation. And Mr. Chair, with your indulgence, I will turn the rest of my remarks over to them.
Okay, very good. And I recognize a couple of those folks, but you still have to tell me your name.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah, I believe so, yes.
Yeah. My name's Rob Woodlick. I'm chairman of Get Up, Stand Up to Cure Paralysis Foundation, citizen advocate for spinal cord research, and a member of the Spinal Cord and Brain Injury Council that reviews grants for Office of Higher Education, which it's an honor to serve on. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to testify today for this important research program and proposed legislation. It's changing, but it is changing the field of spinal cord and brain injury research. I also want to thank Representative Albright, Senator Jensen, for authoring this bill, and the 22 co-authors in the House that are supporting this bill too, and my colleagues that are joining us today. I'm here not just for myself, but I'm also here on behalf of my friends with this debilitating condition, such as my friend Kirk, who broke his neck 2 weeks after having his child, and you know, one of his goals is to independently hold his head again and play with her, and my friend Elliot from Apple Valley, that he has severe neuropathic pain and is mostly bedridden. This injury doesn't go away, doesn't take a break, and it deeply impacts the lives of individuals and family members with this condition. However, we're at a pivotal time where treatments are being researched, starting to show results outside of the labs and into people. The state has funded 8 research projects, and to highlight 2 of these, it helped HCMC open a dedicated brain injury research lab that is performing a 9,000 person study to develop long-term predictive measures for assessing a new traumatic brain injuries. This grant program also helped secure a $1 million investment from Abbott Medical to conduct this research, $125,000 state investment. Two other programs that are projects that are very similar are the epidural stimulation being conducted at University of Minnesota, HCMC, and Minneapolis VA, working together to use spinal cord stimulators and assess and bring more data to develop treatments and bring it to the deliverable field for people with spinal cord injuries. In similar studies, this intervention is allowing those with spinal cord injuries to stand, move, and regain bodily functions that are normally impaired with this injury. This project has brought in $240,000 So out of the around 250,000 investment, 240,000 was matched by St. Jude Medical to cover the cost of the stimulators. And the researchers are currently in talks with the Ontario Neurotrauma Fund to expand this trial with a $5 million grant. Researchers on this project told us that this project would not have started if it were not for this state grant program, which they and we are very thankful. From these three grants of $376,000, 1.24, or around 330%, have been received in external funding so far in the last 2 years. And we're expecting more. While this funding is making an impact, these grants are relatively small in the medical research field. Average federal grants for medical research are around 250 to 3 million or more. Researchers and institutions are waiving their income and covering expenses to make these projects work with the limited funds that the state has to offer through this program. Over the past 2 years, there were 22 grant applications. We were only able to support 36% of those. Significance, there are two current clinical trials in the first stages of implementation. We're seeking funding increase to have the opportunity to ensure that the trials are successful, move to the market, and ultimately commercialization. We're interested in providing treatments for paralysis and not just simply research for research. Researchers and people surviving from these conditions are depending on state and federal support for this area of research because current market forces are going up there. With more funding for this research grant program, we'll be able to help more researchers explore and develop effective treatments, enhance medical innovation, and help Minnesotans in need. This bill also proposes adding a scholarship program for the Minnesota higher education students to receive stipends to get experience in spinal cord and brain injury research in the state. This will enable students to strengthen their experience, be competitive on the global level earlier in their careers, and encourage students that are passionate about spinal cord injury research to enter the field. This will assist in to create a pipeline of new scientists and new ideas in Minnesota into this very challenging field of study to enter. The proposal was brought to the council from researchers who serve on the state council, and it's also supported by our community members and is modeled after a successful scholarship program which operates under the state's regenerative medicine program. This bill also seeks, to add one more. With the two additional members, we're seeking to add one veteran and one physician, because currently there's only one veteran and one physical medicine rehab doctor on the council. And when we do the grant reviews, we typically split up into spinal cord and brain injury and then review the grant separately. And so this will add more balance to the board. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, this program funds the best and most promising ideas in spinal cord and traumatic brain injury research in the state. With patient representation, and it is impacting the pace of delivering life-changing treatments for over 110,000 Minnesotans with spinal and brain injuries, which cannot come soon enough. We're looking for results, and we're starting to get them. With this state's support, we hope to continue this program and increase the meaningful impact of this program and that is helping boost medical innovation and improving lives. Thank you.
All right, thank you. I know you've worked really hard to get to this point, so we'll keep you going if we can. Another testifier, please identify yourself.
Yes. Thank you, Chairman and committee members. My name is Chris Nozell. I'm a resident of Burnsville, Minnesota, living with the effects of traumatic brain injuries, which is often called the invisible disability. In January of 2011, I was T-boned in an intersection after a driver fell asleep behind the wheel and ran a red light. My life changed in an instant, and I have continued deficits which affect my thinking, balance, and sensory processing. A disabling auto accident can happen to anyone, anytime, anywhere. I am a citizen advocate for the Minnesota Brain Injury Alliance, and I'm a member of the Department of Higher Education's Spinal Cord and Traumatic Brain Injury Research Advisory Council. We meet several times a year to vote on proposals from investigators around the state whom are seeking funding for innovative spinal cord and brain injury research. Minnesota is the leader in traumatic brain injury rehab, and we need to continue establishing ourselves as a model for other states to follow. Since the effects of sports concussions have grabbed national attention, that has advanced the discussion to consider the effects of all brain injuries for everyone affected, not just athletes. Falls, auto accidents, being struck by objects, and violence are the leading causes of brain injuries, and these can happen to anyone. Our healthcare systems must be more prepared to treat brain injuries because the number of affected individuals is 6 times greater than the number of breast cancer, HIV, AIDS, and multiple sclerosis patients combined. Brain injuries clearly cost the state a lot of money, but we can reverse that to some degree. Significant medical progress can happen quickly with the combined efforts of excellent research and doctors. I myself am a grateful recipient of innovative therapy treatments at Hennepin County Medical Center, which have only been around since 2014. After my accident in 2011, I went through years of therapy and made great gains in cognitive rehab, but I still struggled with how I functioned in the busy world around me. Processing movement, lights, and noise causes disequilibrium, fatigue, and sensory overstimulation. I have coped by using compensation techniques like limiting my driving, wearing earplugs, using visors as I've used here today with some of the fluorescent lights. And another thing that I had to do was synchronize my head, body, and eye movements at the same time to avoid dizziness. I kind of moved robotically to a certain degree. And I still avoid noisy, busy, and bright settings when I can. Quite honestly, not leaving my house or being in a space where I can control my environment is still my preference, but that's not a very satisfying or realistic way to live. So I sought out second opinions. Last spring, I became an outpatient at HCMC's Traumatic Brain Injury Clinic, where I was diagnosed with 4 additional complications from my brain injuries. I completed 65 appointments, the majority of which were for visual processing deficits diagnosed by their developmental optometry experts. I completed over 200 hours of therapies at the clinics and at home, and although my functioning will never quite be the same as it was before, my ability to function in the world has improved dramatically, so much so that I'm actually working a professional job in clinical research again. This would have been unlikely just 1 year ago without those therapies. It is estimated that 40 to 90% of brain injury patients who don't fully recover have these visual processing deficits like I do, which is caused by disrupted communication between the brain injury and the optical nerves and muscles. The developmental optometry treatment at HCMC is an excellent example of the kind of innovative treatment which can help patients immediately. Coincidentally, as I mentioned, my professional background is also in research, so I know firsthand about the amount of effort, funding, and time required to advance medical therapies so they can be made available to the public. There are plenty of brain injury patients in Minnesota whom can be helped. Sadly, over 100,000 of us live with a traumatic brain injury disability. So the people will come forward when we provide the research and hope for functional improvement. New therapies are critical for patients so we can resume as much functionality as we can to return to work and living life fully. Please vote yes to continued and increased funding for the Spinal Cord and Traumatic Brain Injury Research Advisory Council. The funds distributed by this council will help thousands of current and future Minnesotans with spinal cord and brain injuries. Thank you, Chairman and committee members.
Thank you very much. Any questions of members? Representative Albright, do you have one other testifier? Or is that it?
Mr. Chair, I'll leave it with those remarks, knowing full well that anything I say after this will diminish what they've said.
Well, they did very well. I guess there are no questions. Very important. I think the funding was, is it 2 years ago or last year?
Two years ago.
Yeah. So it's great to hear what's happened since then. Very encouraging. So at this point, then, House File 1206 will be laid over for possible inclusion.
Thank you very much, Chair.
Thank you much.
Thank you.
Okay, Representative Bernardy. Ready?
Sure.
Okay. This is House File 1067, and the chair moves that will be laid over for possible inclusion. So now you can begin.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I appreciate the opportunity to be here today. And, you know, a lot of times we hear at the Capitol about all the partisanship and combative stuff, but there's a lot of good things that happen at the Capitol, too, that where we work together and get something passed. And this is one of these bills, and I just want to share with you and thank the members on the committee who have signed on so far, and I want to welcome the other members to sign on as well. I think you will likely be interested. Representative or Chair Nornes is our second on this bill, and then it's Representative Loon, Chair of K-12 Finance Committee, and then we have the lead on the Finance Committee, Jim Dabney, Representative Dabney, and Representative O'Neill. Representative Omar, Representative Pryor, and Representative Christensen are on this bill as well, as other people are too. So I just wanted to share how this has gained bipartisan support throughout our legislature and support throughout the state. I have two amazing testifiers today who have come to share the importance of this and the story about the success of students in their school in closing the achievement gap and helping them be successful in college, as well as talking about how this would create the pathway and sustainability in making sure that our concurrent enrollment and we'll be able to be sustainable throughout the years to come. We have a short window of opportunity here, 5 years, to get our teachers the training they need to be able to meet the requirements for the National Learning, I gotta make sure I get that right, the Higher Learning Commission. So first I'd like to introduce the bigger picture of our local schools, which I represent the Mounds View schools, and Arundel High School happens to be in my school district for one of the high schools. And with us is Superintendent Chris Lennox, and then I will be introducing our next guest too as well after that.
Okay, Mr. Lennox, welcome.
Thank you.
Begin your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, committee members. I'm here today because we do support this legislation. And I think many folks will talk to you about how this can work. I really wanted to come today to talk about why you should do this, why we need to do this. In our story at Mounds View Public Schools, we can agree with the Minnesota Department of Education and Minnesota State. We're all on record about the value of concurrent enrollment programming, stating that concurrent enrollment programs increase student access to post-secondary education. They provide students with the skills necessary to be successful in college. They expand the range and courses that are available to students while they're in high school, allow students the opportunity to earn college credits while in high school, making college more affordable to our students. They allows them to save time and money while earning their college degree. And they've been proven to increase both post-secondary success as well as completion rates for students. The other thing we've seen is they continue to serve an increasingly diverse student population. All of that is true in Moundsview Public Schools. I believe it's true if you look broadly statewide in the concurrent enrollment courses in the districts and the students that for whom they serve. That's why we so appreciate this legislation moving forward. I think it supports districts' efforts assisting our faculty, certainly in Moundsview and I think across the state, in working to meet those higher learning commission credentials that are necessary for our teachers to continue to teach these courses. For impact, I'd like to share what this has done for students in the Moundsview public schools, and I'll use data from last year's graduating class, the class of 2016. 90% of graduates from that class in Moundsview took college level courses. Over 14,000 college credits were earned. 85% of those graduates earned at least 3 credits at college or college level credits. 63% of the graduates earned a semester or more of college credits, allowing them to advance into their post-secondary career a semester ahead. There were 13 of our graduates last year who chose to complete their Associates of Arts degree. 8 of those were female, 5 male. 35% of those students were students of color, and 30% qualified for free and reduced lunch. This is making a difference. It's helping us close the achievement gap. We estimate that at $250 a credit, the total value for students and families in our school district was $3,563,750, a substantial value to students and families. And we're just one school district. That was just one graduating class. Imagine the impact that concurrent enrollment programming is having across the state of Minnesota. But more importantly, imagine the impact if Minnesota students and families lose this opportunity because we can't remove the barriers to get our teachers credentialed. We need your help. We need this legislation. If you believe in equity, if you believe in access for all students, then you really must help us close this opportunity gap by making these programs available to all teachers, helping them get their credentials, therefore making them available to all of our students in Minnesota. Thank you.
All right, thank you. We have another testifier, Representative Bernardy.
I sure do, and he'll introduce himself as well, and he'll make sure he gets his name correct because I may not have it exactly right. And this is a teacher from Irondale High School. He lives in our community, and he is highly credentialed a teacher in the state of Minnesota, so he's a great person to testify on this bill, and his name is Rich Rosevack.
Mr. Chairman, thank you so much for having me here today. I am Rich Rosevack. I'm a National Board Certified Teacher at Irondale High School. And I wanted to begin just a little bit and comment on what Representative Bernardy and Superintendent Lennox had said and establish some context for this legislation. A little over a year ago, we had a change from the Higher Learning Commission about credentialing standards related to concurrent enrollment, and that increased the number of credits that people are required to have to teach these courses. So faculty like me in a high school setting who are teaching the college level course, from a master's in 16 credits to a master's in 18 credits. There were also some other things in terms of tightening the requirements that they had about how those credits would be viewed. What that did is it set off a series of alarms about how we would provide a sustainable way of ensuring that this program that Superintendent Lennox was talking about was going to continue and to serve the needs of our students, not just in Moundsview, but statewide. Over the past year, I've been fortunate to participate in a partnership with Education Minnesota, the interfaculty organization, which represents the four-year university faculty at the colleges, the Minnesota State College faculty, which represents the two-year college faculty, and the Minnesota State System Office. in developing a comprehensive approach to how to address the challenges that this new ruling from the HLC provided. And this legislation works very well with a plan that we've developed to address those needs. One of the initial concerns that teachers had coming out of that decision was, if I'm going to get these 18 credits, how will I do that? We found that many of the credits that people wanted to take in order to meet the standard would be offered in places that were not accessible, at times they couldn't get to. And so the burden fell on teachers to try to resolve these problems without pathways that were available from the universities. One of the things that emerged last year was the Northwest Partnership, which was an attempt and a pilot program to say, let's do something. Because I will tell you that teachers care so deeply about their students, we did not want to see these opportunities go by the wayside. When the Northwest Partnership opened up as an opportunity, a colleague of mine, Dennis Fisher at Wheaton High School in Traverse County, he jumped right on the opportunity. He's a calculus instructor. He's been teaching AP calculus for a number of years, but his students were able to stay at Wheaton and to not leave their community and have to go full-time PSEO outside of that rural community. And he wanted to see those students be able to stay. When I talked about the impact of this bill and the opportunity for people to work in programs that are designed by university faculty to directly address the needs of teachers, with people in my own school, Ann Kierstead, who is a calculus teacher in my school, honestly did this. Yes! Okay, I mean, that was her response. The teachers wanted this. What this bill does is it creates that opportunity for us to advance this. Now, Representative Bernardy talked about the five-year window. So we have, within this partnership and the plans that we've talked about and what the HLC has given us, an opportunity to get people who are not currently meeting the standard to the standard. And within that 5 years, teachers need time to plan their lives. They need time to make decisions about how they're going to pursue their career interests. This bill significantly advances the opportunities that we have to do that in a timely way that respects the educators, ensures that the credentials that our students are earning are meeting the standard that we have, and that there will be no question about whether or not the college credits that are earned by our students are in fact college credits, and that they are going to help our students complete their degrees wherever they go. Now, I will tell you, there are a few things that I hope that your committee will continue to examine. Certainly as we look at the Northwest Partnership and a pilot program, I think there are some things that we're already learning about how that's functioning, and I hope that your committee will hear from people in the partnership and look at ways to adjust in, and I think that this bill allows for flexibility to adjust that partnership and to make sure that the learnings that we receive from that are carried forward into a broader program. I'm also hopeful that we have an opportunity to talk also about how to take some of the teachers that we know who are maybe only needing 3 or 6 credits, not a full 18 credits, and ways to help them get to completing that credential in a timely way as well. And so there are some things I think that we could still do to work on this, but this bill is a great start, and it's a great opportunity to move this really pressing issue forward. So thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Good. Thank you. Questions? The appropriation is blank, I see. Any estimates on what, if you had a wish, that might be?
Well, I actually talked to someone who may testify, and they've done some research working with Greater Minnesota and what their estimate of the cost with the reduced tuition, that if we expanded this statewide, and he can verify this, that they're expecting it to be maybe $3 to $4 million per year.
We only have a few more minutes of the committee, but if you can briefly respond to that.
Mr. Chair and members, my name is Sam Walseth. I represent both the Minnesota Rural Education Association and the Minnesota Service Cooperatives, who were very much involved in passage of the Northwest Partnership with your support last year. That's a partnership between Lakes Country Cooperative out of Fergus Falls and Minnesota State University Moorhead. The financing for that was based on an economic model of a graduate tuition credits being offered at $150 per credit, which is a substantial reduction over what you see as the typical retail price of graduate credits. And so as you look at what you might need to take this type of model statewide, and there is immense demand and pressure to make this either the partnership statewide or another offering statewide, because that partnership is really only geared toward the market share up in Northwest Minnesota. And so we've got many other corners of the state of Minnesota. We've got about 1,400 concurrent enrollment staff across our high schools and then in the metro area as well looking for help. And so the economic modeling for this really depends upon what Minnesota State campuses or potentially some of the private colleges would be willing to offer those graduate tuition credits at. These, again, don't have to be degree-seeking graduate credits, so perhaps Minnesota State would be willing to create a tier of tuition that would be lower than what you see as a typical graduate price. In addition, the Northwest Partnership is also covering the tuition costs for the teachers who are participating in it. So that's an additional cost. And there are there's some costs involved too with course development. These are a new cohort of courses that were needed to be developed as well. So depends on a lot of factors and a lot of variables about to determine what you might need for resources. And it depends on what potential partners at in higher ed are willing to offer. So
all right.
It depends. We have ideas. We have hallway math, but it would depend on some answers from higher ed, sure, as well. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Work in progress. Representative Bernardy, I appreciate you bringing this bill to us, and I think we will continue to work on it. So for the meantime, House File 1067 is laid over for possible inclusion.
Thank you.
All right.
Mr.
Thank
Chair,
you very
members.
Much. And members, that's the end of our agenda. Meeting adjourned.